Nowadays, control charts are widely used in industry and in any process that requires statistical supervision. It should be pointed out that the selected process and characteristic, i.e. the parameter that will be monitored, must first fulfill the conditions necessary for the use of the control chart. The characteristic under examination must be free of special causes, and the normality test for statistical analysis must be passed. In order to define a special cause, it's best to refer to the ISO 35342 definition, according to which it's a source of process or quality variation that comes from the outside. For instance, this is deliberate over, regulation made by a human being, interference of the power supply to a device, damage to a tool, etc. A normality test is carried out to assure that the statistic under study is indeed a normal distribution. Obtaining this result makes us sure that we may control the process statistically, so both control charts and other SPC tools are applicable. In the event that the normality test is not passed, the process may not be controlled, or it needs to be worked on and improved to become so. Statistics, where special causes appear, very rarely pass normality testing, and these disturbances are the main reason for the existence of processes that are under no control. The chart allows for a graphical representation of the values of the characteristic under study that come about due to an examination of random sampling. The main parameters in effect while recording any control chart are sampling frequency, i.e. time intervals, or how many products we take the sample size n, sample size n, i.e. the number of products taken from the process and used to measure a given characteristic. The control chart is a form of a chart where measurement data taken on samples from the process will be placed. The graphic form of the chart makes it possible to bring awareness to the most important parameters, visualizing the status of a given process. Now, look at the chart on the slide. We will designate control limits, warning limits, central line. The determined limits and the central line correspond to the status of the process at any given moment, with the entry of values resulting from the examination of each sample taken. There are three possible options. First option, the process is within the warning limits. Here, the process status is OK. Second option, the process goes beyond the warning limits but does not exceed control limits. In this situation, you must pay attention to what is happening and observe the process. Third option, the process goes beyond the control limits. The process is non-compliant and a response is required. Due to the graphic form of the chart, it can be easily seen when the characteristic under study is approaching or is within the warning limits. At this point in time, there is no need to react to pay closer attention to the process. In other words, the person supervising the process must wait for a subsequent sample to be taken and get on with the other work. On the other hand, any point outside the warning limits, but not exceeding the control limits, gives a clear visual signal that something is happening in the process that should not be happening. From that moment on, therefore, attention should be paid, e.g., to settings or other factors affecting the characteristic. If the control limits are exceeded, this is readily visible on the chart and the person supervising the process should immediately take action, because it means that the process is running away and that there is a quality control problem at hand, or that some special factor disturbing the process has occurred. This requires addressing the situation right away by confirming its existence, usually by taking further samples and, if needed, making an adjustment in the process and, following this, taking further samples to see if the non-compliance has been remedied. What is interesting, it often turns out that a process that seems to be stable and is within the warning limits is not always correct either. Here, we apply statistical principles that bring to light certain situations where the process apparently looks right, but the results from the samples taken indicate otherwise. There are many similar situations in which this is so. So, I have selected a few of the most common. The first of such examples is seeing the examined process reaching 9 or more points in a row above or below the center line. This means that the process has moved to where such points have been recorded, and there must be a reason. Despite the fact that the process is within the warning limits, it's necessary to immediately interrupt the process and the trend. Another example is the occurrence of a continuously increasing or decreasing trend. Indeed, just 6 points in a row can indicate that there is a shift in the process mean value away from the target value, and there may be a permanent disturbance causing this effect. We should therefore interrupt the process and this trend. In most cases, this effect is due to wear and tear on machinery, inadequate maintenance, or even improper handling by production staff. The situation is different when we note 14 consecutive points, alternating up and down, and it does not matter whether they are beyond the limits or near the center line. If such a trend is detected, it can be expected that the process is continuously affected by two opposing causes. For instance, raw materials from two different sources of supply, from two suppliers, or from different production batches being taken into the process. In practical applications of the charts, the two different types of limits, warning and control, are not used, and the so-called control limits are the only ones noted. Of course, we will have two types of such limits, an upper control limit and a lower control limit. The control limits correspond to the warning limits. Control limits can be calculated from appropriate statistical formulae. Their graphical representation is linked to a very important distribution parameter, the standard deviation, sigma. 3 sigma limits is a statistical calculation where the data are within 3 standard deviations from a mean. So, the entire area within the limits corresponds to 6 sigma and holds 99.73% of the whole distribution, which corresponds to the Shewhart principle. Let's move on to discuss the subsequent issue, which is the selection and creation of control charts. In order to apply the control charts to the product, the following procedure must be carried out. Select the characteristic to be tested on the product or process. This could be, for instance, the weight of the product or an important dimension of the product, such as the length of an item. Select the right type of control chart for the chosen characteristic. The characteristic examined will determine the type of control chart. Establish sampling rules. Here we decide what the sample size N and sampling frequency will be. Calculate the control limits according to the established formulas. Build a graphic design for the control chart or create a suitable form. Finally, start completing the data and learn to respond according to the aforementioned rules. As previously stated, the characteristic of a product or process examined affects the selection of the type of control chart. In other words, the way we evaluate the process. We will have two types of control charts. Variable control charts, where we obtain a numerical result directly from the measurement of the sample, e.g. the length of an item, and attributable control charts, where we obtain a result other than the numerical measurement result, e.g. we'll be interested in the percentage of non-compliance in a sample. To put it simpler, there will be two types of control charts, variable and attributable. In the case of variable control charts, we will use known statistical measures. These include mean value, median, standard deviation, range. It's worth remembering that variable control charts do not have just one measure, but are constructed from two indicators. The most popular control chart is X-bar R-chart. The occurrence of two measures is due to the possibility of an error in the mean, which will not be visible on the X-bar, but will be visible on the R-chart. An example is the measurement of the weight of an item, where very different pieces can, on average, give a result close to the target. Only the gap between the individual weight measurements shows that there is something wrong with the sample taken. Instead of the X-bar R-chart, the MR chart with the median can be used. It then replaces the mean value. As can charts based on the mean value and XS standard deviation, or even charts with the single measurements and XJR range. This all depends on the characteristic of the product or process being evaluated and our experience. In the case of attributable control charts, the choice is also quite large. The most popular charts are NP chart, which are based on the number of non-compliance units in a sample of N. This chart can be used to control products with minor defects on the product that are more than 5%. P chart, these are used to examine the percentage of non-conformities in a sample of N. This chart can be used to control products with major defects, of which there are relatively many, more than 5%. C chart, such charts are based on the number of non-conformities in a fixed sample size, per batch, per shift, per day, per machine, etc., with quality defects being rare, less than 5%. U-chart. A U-chart is built upon the number of non-conformities per unit of product. This indicator is calculated as the ratio of the number of defects to the number of units tested, e.g. length of pipe, number of lots.